All right, so welcome to Mobile Portland. My name is Jason Grigsby. I'm one of the organizers here. Thank you guys for coming. We're just going to go through a bit of logistics and then get right into the heart of the meeting. This is a typical agenda, a little bit of networking, some introductions, so we'll talk about some upcoming events and announcements, and then we'll get right into the presentation. For how many of you is this your first Mobile Portland meeting? Please raise your hand. Awesome. Welcome. So, here's the deal. Mobile Portland. We meet on the fourth Monday of every month, except for when that coincides with the holiday, which it does next month. So it's not the fourth Monday next month, it is the third Monday next month, which happens to be May 19th. Somebody correct me. 19th, is that correct? Yes? Okay, good.
Sure.
We meet on Mondays because of so this is the thing. During the presentation, the microphone is going to cut out, and it's just the way it is.
All sign.
Yes. We use the microphones, though, because we do recordings. We post them on mobileportland.com, and if you're interested in finding out about future meetings, go to that website. Sign up for a mailing list. There are two mailing lists. There's one that is just an announcements-only mailing list that gets, like, month, and that's it. There is also a Google group that you can join, and that's a place where you can post job opportunities or projects that you're working on, look for developers, look for collaborators on the things that you're doing. We also are on Twitter at Mobile Portland, and I should really take off the bit about, IRC, because that's really not happening anymore. I want to take a moment and thank our sponsors. We've got a great group of sponsors, and they are responsible for getting us the meeting space, helping us set up the promotions, market the event, providing the food, and we're also hoping the sponsors are also going to be contributing towards us bringing in speakers from other parts of the country, so they are contributing heavily to the future of Mobile Portland. I'm going to start off by having Ramsey speak a little bit about Urban Airship.
Hi, I'm Ramsey. I work for Urban Airship. We're here on the third floor in the Meyer and Frank building. Urban Airship's a great place to work. It's a lot of fun. We have a few job recs open. If you guys have questions about working here or anything like that, come talk to me afterwards. I'm more than happy to talk about Urban Airship. So, thanks.
And what's great is Ramsey is not a, he's a developer, engineer. He is not like a HR person, so he'll give you the full scoop. And Urban Airship has like push notifications and in-app purchase and all sorts of awesome stuff, iBeacons. Rob is here somewhere. Ah, there we go, Rob with RearMark.
Yeah, I'm Rob, I'm with RearMark Community Credit Union. We're just a local credit union, serve the 11 counties out here, everywhere from Dallas to Newburgh and down to Salem. And yeah, we're trying to be put the branch in your hands. We're working on it.
Are you guys still hiring?
We are. We actually filled our front end UX developer position. He's actually here this evening. We're still hiring for the software engineer position.
Okay, awesome. All right, and then John, ProFocus.
Yeah, thank you. Hi. My name's John Boone. I'm the founder of ProFocus. ProFocus is a technology staffing company, and we're totally focused here on technology in Portland. And we make placements on contract to hire, and direct hire basis. And for technology professionals, we offer to learn about your goals and your career goals and help you find the next great job or project. And for companies, we learn a lot about your needs and all the details of the positions that you have, and just really carefully submit just the right candidates for your positions. We come to meetings like this so we can learn about all the latest in technologies, kind of live up to our motto, which is technology staffing by people who understand technology. I'd like to meet you, so please introduce yourself to me at the end of the meeting. I'll be here.
Thank you, John. Is anyone from Pi here? I thought Rick was going to do this to me. So Rick Tarozzi, who is one of the organizers of Pi, Rick Pi is a sponsored the event, but Rick is notorious for taking every opportunity to avoid public speaking. when he can get away with it. And so I think what he did was put me on the spot for talking about that. So if you have not heard about PI, PI is the Portland Incubator Experiment. Their office is like two blocks that way or three blocks that way. It's a program where if you have an idea for a startup, you can submit an application, you can become part of the program, you get great mentors, you get some amount of, I don't think it's like capital, it's some working money to work on the idea with them. A lot of companies have come out of it. Urban Airship is one of the famous examples of that. Quite a few other startups that have had success have come out of PI, and they have applications open right now. The deadline is next Monday, so and they're seeking people who are interested in participating in that program. So please, PIPDX.com. Deadline is Thursday. I am a mentor, I should have known that. I'm a bad mentor. It's Wednesday. Wow, you guys, like time is slipping by. What are you waiting for? Okay, so now, briefly, ever so briefly, if you have job announcements or upcoming events that are relevant, please just take like 10 seconds. Tell us what's going on, or if you're looking for work, raise your hand and I'll walk around with a microphone. Really? Wow, this is interesting. Okay, all right, well, we will just move on. So I'm very excited to have Dee Madden here to talk about choosing the right stack for mobile. Dee is a mobile solutions consultant with Soft Source Consulting. More importantly, he was telling me in an email that at some point he just got to the point where all of the people, all the clients that he was working with kept asking these questions about the different technology stacks, and he was like, okay, we just have to own this. We have to go figure out this problem and get a sense of what the various challenges are with each of the platforms. So he's going to talk about a whole range of different ways to build applications and the strengths and benefits and disadvantages of each. So please join me in welcoming Dee.
Greetings, fellow Masons, Shriners, denizens of Discordia. I'm Dee, like Grigsby over there said. I am going to talk about a bunch of different ways that mobile apps can be built. Like Jason was saying, just through my travels and through lots of experimentation and getting thrown at a lot of different things, sort of fell just through my travels and fallen upon less than a handful of ways that most people sort of tackle this problem, and I'm going to try to cover it as best as I can. But I wanted to start by talking about this, because when I was talking to Jason by email about this topic, because it's a topic that's been done before, so I understand it. Jason's done it, and I think I've even seen other people do similar stuff. The thing I was going to point out is that I don't really see this as a debate. I feel like when businesses based on their resources and their budget and whatever it is what they have at hand, and resources and budget mainly, and what they have in the way of people that can build stuff. If there's, you know, there's one or two things that are probably going to make the most sense for them to do. And it may be native, it may be hybrid, it may be Xamarin. It just really depends on the shop. So I didn't really want it to be, I've never really thought about this as being like a debate. I just felt like it was a thing. Again, that there's just the right solution. And Jason sent this thing around and was like, oh, hey, listen, native guy, I'm native man, and you are HTML5 man, and it's a big debate kind of thing set up. And I'm all about peace, love and jog. Jay Cole knows. I'm a lover, not a fighter. I'm all about peace and flower power. Bobby Sherman, Timothy Leary, and I like to have protests of peace and love, and I like to tune in and turn on and drop out, So that's where I'm coming from with all this stuff. I'm nothing but love for all of it, and again, I feel like whatever people think is best for them is the thing to use. So, backstory. So like Jason was saying, when I first started working at SoftSource, I had a lot of conversations with Steve, who runs the show now, and we shared an affinity for mobile stuff, and we really wanted to get into it, and we went down this path of looking for things cross-platform things, like solutions that you could write code once and deploy everywhere. And it was right about the time that MonoTouch came out, and Mono for Android came out, and we started playing with that stuff. It wasn't really ready for prime time. And then just through working on stuff and going to other shops, Jason said at some point I came into a company meeting and just said, there isn't really. There's no way as a firm to have this message of hey, we're the Xamarin implementers, or we're the hybrid solution thing for whatever. I really kind of felt like you sort of need to know all of it, because hybrid doesn't always make sense for this guy over here, and Xamarin doesn't make sense for this guy over here. Maybe they want is to be able to support iOS. And they can just have it be native. It really just depends on the problem and what the people are trying to do. So I started, over time, working on stuff. I began to form this whole idea of you really just look at the problem and then come up with the right thing for it. So. I'm talking here primarily in the enterprise context. Most of the stuff that I've been through has been through the enterprise. Talk on the mic, Dee. You'll start up and you do a line of business stuff. I don't know that this really applies as much to games. I know there's a lot of game developers that can come to these things. I've heard you guys chime in. Oh, thank you. Thanks. So, I could be talked out of it. I feel like most of the things that I'm going to be talking about that have more to do with non-game stuff, for what it's worth. And again, this is all about just looking at the things that are out there and what people are using right now. And I don't really have much of a religious attachment or not really to any of it. I'm going to talk about some of the more common options that are in the landscape now. If I were to do this next week or tomorrow, an hour from now, some of this stuff would change. But the stuff that I continually come across within the things that I've done is native, in what I call roll your own hybrid, which is building your own native container for a hybrid solution. Shrink wrap, what I call shrink wrap hybrid, which is like PhoneGap, Accelerator. Stuff like that. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about using Xamarin and a little shared code base, a shared code base approach that my friend Jay Caldwell just turned me on to today. That's pretty cool. That I thought I'd show you guys. And I'm going to do a little dusting of this thing that I call drive-through hybrid, which is using this online service called Codica, which has an online HTML IDE that you can use to build a hybrid app and have it built and then get the IDE package back. There's that. I'm going to focus on iOS and Android primarily. It's 90% of the market. When you're talking in terms of enterprise, it's been my experience that most of the stuff that I've worked on has been focused primarily on iOS and Android, so the stuff I'm going to be showing you guys is all revolving around that. And I'm going to try to use this this reference application that I built for this class that I had done internally for SoftSource. And then I'm just using variant forms of that to show that to you as an example.
You can try the other one too. I'm not sure if it's any better.
Guys, can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so.
It's on the bottom. What's that? I'm going to turn it off. Just the bottom, the whole thing is fine. I wrote this little application it's like a scavenger game, and it has these different levels, and each one has a collection of items that the players are supposed to try to find. And use the geolocation to try to figure out if you're close enough to the item, and then sort of qualifies it as something that's found based on your proximity to the item that you found. You take a picture of it. So, there's a bunch of stuff in here, there's a dog leash, great game, Jay Paul's silver necklace. And then the fight. So, if I found Jay Paul's silver necklace, I'll take a picture of it. Now, I'm in a native view right now. I just jumped out to a native view. It, and it's maybe in a post to our REST service. It says we go back. And then pause here. Look at this now. See that it calculated the distance. Now I'm working with dummy data, so I was just using writing stuff out the console to make sure we can. You can see here's the item that I was trying to find, and here's the object associated with it. And then it took my coordinates, and then it's a map, and found it. It's some stuff based on that. So it's got a timer, and stuff like that, and keep doing this kind of stuff. And then it also, something that's kind of hard to do from hybrid actually. Actually saving stuff to the camera. Which you can't see. That was weird. Crazy. But you can see there's a picture of that. This silver necklace. Yeah, it's a silver necklace. So, just wanted to show you guys that. Now, talk about native. Native. And we're going to talk about that. So
that can be made for native, of course, is it, and Mr. Grigsby dedicates this term. But you know, the thing is it, when I was talking to him about this in email, hit that term to life, and I was like, so Apple. You know, yeah, it's kind of a braiding term when you first hear it, but what else do you call it? What else do you call that tangible thing that happens when you start playing with something, you start going, oh, and so you can find yourself playing with it, you're not even thinking about it. It's native, it seems to be, it tends to be, and I can be talked out of this, and it really does depend on the things you're trying to build, but native in general tends to be a more delightful experience. You can do things with it that are tougher to do with hybrid. It's a little bit easier to get to stand something up and get it up and running pretty quickly. And depending on what you're doing, it tends to be a lot easier to build out the UI and to build out platform-specific user experience. The thing about hybrid, a lot of times, is that you end up spending a lot of time, particularly in the middle, like when you're working on the styling and CSS animation, spend a lot of time trying to recreate things that you just get for free. Things that just happen for free. Transitions and stuff, like in iOS in particular. A lot of that stuff just happens, you know, depending on what you're working on, it happens magically. You actually have to write code to make it not do that stuff. And you can find yourself spending a lot of time trying to make that magic happen with CSS. What else? Well, you know, while it is true that, I'm not talking. Can you guys hear me okay?
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, okay. I just like talking. Is it because I just like talking? I was going to say. Yeah, so hardware access, while it is true that you can do a lot of the things that you normally get to do with native in hybrid, you know, HTML does have camera access, has access to audio, has access to a lot of this stuff. It just tends to be a little bit easier to work with it, the native APIs to get this thing done, deal with it, stuff like that. It's usually quite a bit more performant, particularly when you're doing things with large data sets. Something that we found, I was working recently for a large shoe vendor that I'm not allowed to say the name, Buster Brown Shoes. And Buster Brown Shoes had this thing that I worked on for a long time. We started out going hybrid with it, and ran into some issues with hybrid, and we ended up gradually, incrementally, migrating the whole thing to native. And the reason being is that we had a couple of views that were table views in particular that had to work with these data sets that had to live inside of a tablet, inside of iPad devices. It could be as much as, it could be tens of thousands of rows. Now, those tens of thousands of rows didn't have to actually get displayed in the view, but it had to be able to very nimbly filter those views, filter that data and display it. And we were having some issues doing that with hybrid, and we went off and did a little bit of extra work, figured out that native was left, just did that stuff better. There's not a lot of dependence. While you can use some third-party stuff, and there are some pretty common third-party things to use for certain things with Android and iOS, you're not really as dependent upon it as you would be when you're building a hybrid app. When you build a hybrid app, assuming that you're doing something, you know, a very modern web kind of thing, the first thing you got to do is to start thinking about, well, am I going to use a JavaScript MVC framework? If I do that, which one am I going to use? What's everyone likes? What are all the cool kids using right now? What jQuery plugins do I need? You know, you have to spend a lot of time assembling those building blocks, but you don't have to do that as much. The cost to stand that stuff up is not as much as, you know, and I'm talking about this probably more in up against other solutions like Xamarin or CentureTouch, you know, where there is a fair amount of money you have to build out to keep going. iOS, you know, you spend like $100 a year. Android is like $30 or something.
got to write the app more than once. Yeah, if you want to support, want to build something that has to support iOS, Android, or this phone, then you're writing that app three times. And then if you are building for tablet, then depending on what you're doing, the experience for the tablet has to be a little bit different. And it multiplies out, and you're building it four or five times. A lot of shops do that. You know, there are shops that have their Android teams and their iOS teams and their Windows teams, and that's how they build things. In the perfect world, in most cases, it's probably the best way to do it. It's a tougher resource and infrastructure problem, right? Because if you are a business and you've got a collection of guys that work on a house web app, they work on back-end services, the Java guys, or .NET guys, it's going to be hard to reuse some of those resources to build something like a native iOS app or a native Android app, depending on your skills. Then you have to start looking for people to use. Well, I mean, if all you need is some kind of one-off mobile thing that is mobile-fying some pre-existing functionality, then you spend a lot of money that you probably don't want to spend for the purposes of something like that. So it's tough. It's tough. It's a hard thing to do. Hard to say. Okay. So, at this point I thought I would, anybody have any questions about any of that stuff?
Yeah.
Anybody want to shoot me, kick me in the shins?
Can you find what you mean by hiring?
So, I guess I'm characterizing hybrid as anything, any mobile solution that you're building that involves where the web view figures prominently into the solution. So pure hybrid would be like a single web view that contains a web application, and then has some and a rest that sits or something in front of it. I should have called that because you know it's a pretty widely used term. It's used also for serving mobile stuff too. So yeah, so just to level set that. When I'm talking about hybrid, I'm talking about a web app in a native container. I'm talking about a server from the site. Okay, there's me. Okay. So I've got a couple of little things I did here. I've got this little native iOS app. And it knows them. So I've got this little pared down version of that items view that you saw in the first version. I'm going to put a little search box in it here. Filter. Look for a little shoe. Look for Stephen Gray's pocket watch. All kinds of stuff. And then I tried to do something similar. Something similar for Android, but this being an Azure environment, there's feature function elements that's will come. This one's called AppJ. So this is just a flat layout table. some of the same data in the images and search box were forthcoming. This is what I can get at a little plateau bottom. Now, when you look at this code side by side, there are some things that you can begin to see that are somewhat similar. But at the end of the day, you are. So here's my iOS project, and a table is a table. So, for the iOS version, I have a view controller that has this little data store that's just a hard coded it's just a static set of data. Look at this. See, all this is it's just bare. It's a bare array of bare dictionaries, and I'm making use of logic rules so that. I can just pass this stuff around as a fair thing. Now, in a real application for iOS, and this is probably true of Android too, right, Jake? Can you do the thing with is there an analog for a fetch results controller?
Yeah,
something like that. When you're working on bigger data sets, there's a thing in iOS called a fetch results controller that allows you to when you're working with big stuff, it's smart enough to figure out the rows that you're actually displaying on the view, which is really powerful. It's a super powerful thing. It does that, and then also this reuse stuff. Have you guys done any iOS code? Okay, well, in a table view, there's a notion of a table cell, which makes up the row of a table, and you can do this reuse thing. And what happens under the covers of iOS is does all this magic to sort of fit to hang on to that cell of memory and reuse it. So when you're the big benefit you get is when you're swiping stuff up and down, sometimes you guys might see if you're in an app and it kind of gets a little hurt and jerky sometimes and goes smooth, it gets hurt and jerky and goes smooth. That's the fetch results controller, or the table cells like doing their magic under the covers and going, oh, I gotta work on it, I gotta work on it. Very hard thing to do in high. Very hard. And you get all that stuff for free. But so I have this table, and then when you build a UI table view, there are delegates that you override to dictate things like from the rows that are going to be in the view. What else? Not too good. There's the reuse stuff. And then for the search filter, I have a little method here that actually calls the array and filters the array using this notion of predicates. They have this notion of predicates in iOS, which is kind of like a where clause for SQL, as you guys know databases, and it filters things that way. Let's guys heard about Xcode? I'll just do so. So you guys like Xcode? Is that okay? Oh, really? You don't like Xcode? No. I came from the non-Xcode world, so. I am a law. Yes, just so you guys know, I actually cracked this open in an IDE that's made by Jeff Brands. You guys make sure of the lab code. I'm a fan, but I can understand what you are. When you're building out something like a table view in iOS, it's a table view in a cell. Turns out that in Android, you understand that you have to build a table with a cell, that a lot of the stuff is quite insane. So in Android, you have to work with this list adapter thing to actually build up the data set and give the view something to bind to. So this is the analog for the main container for Android and iOS. And it's just a basic list view. You can see, I should have said before too, I am using Android Studio for this, which is another thing I like. And so I apologize for all you guys who like it close. And so it's the same kind of thing. You have a table view, and then you build a cell. So this is my cell, and these are all of the text. The labels that exist within inside my cell. So it's kind of the same, but you know, I guess the other thing that I'm reinforcing is if I need to make any changes to this stuff, I got to go into this code base, make a change, even if something as simple as changing or restyling the cell. It has to be done in two places. There's pressure on the business to have the experience consistent between the two, then you know, you spend a lot of time bouncing back and forth those code bases. Questions about that? How am I doing, Jason? Okay. Hybrid. An arguably easy choice for a cross-platform problem. There are a couple of little things that, you know, depending on the shop and what you're trying to do, they're also good, but I can say that based on my travels as of late, it's a solution that people tend to like depending on what they have to work with. Most of the solution is free. For the web app portion, you know, a lot of the stuff that all the cool kids are using now to build these apps, Angular, Backbone, Underscore, Require, all this stuff's free. It's all open source stuff. It's all free. And the nice thing about Angular is it's owned by Google and it's supported by Google and they have all the great documentation. There's a ton of tutorials out there on getting up to something. It's possible to have a more consistent user experience on all platforms if that is a requirement. Jason and I had some back and forth about this. I can say that Jason said that some of the stuff that he worked on, that it was a thing that the client wanted an Android-specific experience and wanted an iOS-specific experience. Most of the stuff that I've worked on, the Buster Brown shoes, the aforementioned Buster Brown shoe, Buster was a stickler. He was like, look, I need consistent experience across everything, across the desktop, across the tablet. So that's what you guys need to give me. For the longest time, because that was a hard requirement, it was tough for the business people before we started working on the Buster Brown project to get it up and running, because they were going down the path of looking at building a native version and just a pure web desktop version, which would have meant two code bases, same thing. We came up with a way to do a hybrid solution where we share the code between the tablet and the desktop, and just to get things off the ground. It worked out great. until the customer got his hands on it and told us that we found out something else. They told us and what they ended up doing with it was things and then sort of chats. If you're working hybrid, then it's HTML. It's truly responsive. You can do a lot of great responsive things with CSS. You can make it fairly platform agnostic. I say platform agnostic, but there are still a few little things you have to do to get things to play on different devices. What else? This is something that I added that Jason pointed out. Excuse me. The hardware is getting better, and I've heard a few people talk about this. And I hadn't really thought about it until I modified this presentation for this. The hardware is getting better. Devices are getting faster. They're getting faster processors. Obviously the faster the processes you get, the more grounding that you have for high-res solution. Early on, that was a big factor. It just didn't run as well. The hardware was concerned. Let's see what else. Yeah. So I already talked about that. The feature support is basically the same. You can do pretty much anything you can do in the way of hardware access. With native, you can do hybrid. You could conceivably set up the HTML, JS, and CSS in such a way that it can be run on a mobile device, tablet, and it could be run as a kiosk, whatever. It's much easier to find the resources to get something like that going. Most of the shops that Andy and I have talked to, spoken to as of late, have web developers. They have web developers on site, and they're kind of keen to get into mobile. Well, then it's an easy thing. It's an easier decision to go with hybrid. It's not something they want to try to do. So there's that. Now, I say with the problems with hybrid, this was a top thing. Yes, you're right. It's not very delightful. I put that in there because every time I ever got the topic of working on a hybrid app of some kind, usually the person that I'm talking to is very quick to say, it's not very delightful. That might not be a requirement. It might not be something that's very important to the business user. So, when you are working with somebody, trying to come up with a little solution for them, it's just it's a litmus test. It's one of the things that you sort of pose to prove out whether a hybrid's going to work for them. Does it need to be that delightful? Does it have to be that fancy? And if they don't understand what you're saying, then you can pull out your phone. Does it need to do this, or do this, or do this, swipe like this? Does it need to have dancing goats? Doesn't, then maybe hybrid will work out. Building out the scaffolding, getting all of the stuff in place for a hybrid solution, ironically, can be a pretty big effort. It's anybody that's ever had to set up an Angular C or set up a backbone C and get some boilerplate going for a whole modern web application, it's a lot of work. It is an awful lot of work to get that stuff up and running and getting it to a point where people can start collaborating on the software. The other thing that I brought up earlier was that the performance can suffer when you start working with large data sets, and when you know that the data sets are getting bigger and bigger, you have to begin to do a lot of things to account for the fact that they're getting bigger and bigger. One of the things you can do is if the data sets are big, then you have to start doing a bunch of extra work to constrain the amount of data that gets sent back up to the JavaScript for the sake of the data. A lot of it, like the phone gas solutions and the accelerators and the memory building data containers is something that we did, the buzzing around solution. You can persist the data inside the data container and then hand it back up to the to the JavaScript is JSON. It's a pretty common pattern. Do stuff like that and the data gets big enough, then that data has to live somewhere. And what ends up happening is that it'll reside in memory long enough that you get really bad memory spikes and you can have things crash if stuff gets too big. So you have to be really, really careful about the amount of data that you're passing back and forth between the native and the JavaScript. You also have to start to do things like if you know that you're working with big rows of large rows of data and tables, doing infinite scrolling stuff. And the infinite scrolling stuff doesn't always work all that well on mobile devices, so you do have to do a lot of treatment for that. So it's just something that when people come to us and talk to us about things that they want to do, it's one of the first things I ask is like how much data are we talking about? How much data are we going to be working with against the problem? Okay. So I'm going to start getting into the hybrid stuff. The first thing I'm going to show with like a small example of rolling your own. Rolling your own is a pretty good option because if you are going to go down the path hybrid, one of the nice things about it is that it's a lot more flexible than going with a solution like PhoneGap because you're writing the code, you're writing the native code. So if you begin to have memory issues within the native code, it's not a black box like the PhoneGaps and the accelerators are, you can actually do things on your own top of mind, so the stuff that's going on in the back of the code between JavaScript. The container portion, the downside of doing that kind of stuff, let me back up. So the other pro is that if you get yourself into a situation where you do find that you need to start mixing native views and hybrid views, which is something you can do, is a lot of apps just do it by design. You can begin to climb out of your web views, any web views that you're having performance issues with, or footprint issues with, or whatever. You can start to climb out of that stuff by just migrating it. It's something you can do to an extent with PhoneGap, but you have to do it through plugins, and you have to do it through their APIs, and it's not as flexible as just building it yourself. Downsides, I said building that container can also take a fair amount of work. It can take a fair amount of work. You still have to know you have to be able to have somebody or have to know the language that you're going to write the container. If you're doing it for iOS, you can have to know if you're going to have Objective-C to build it, you're going to have to know enough Java to be dangerous to build a native container. So there's that. All right.
There's no web.
Could you still build your app in HTML and JavaScript?
No.
JavaScript. So how's UI?
Basically, the UI elements are native.
Native?
Titanium is a huge native library that you control from JavaScript.
If you had said
there's a JavaScript component, then I would say that's what the type is. Maybe it was JavaScript.
That was definitely my ignorance. Anything else?
You were mentioning the problems with memory spikes in hybrid applications with trying to build too much data from the server and how much data you're getting. Like, have you ever dealt with technology like local storage or web SQL?
Yeah, so you can use those things, but they have limits. They have limits to local storage. I don't know what local storage stands now, but I know the last time I looked at it during a research spike for something I was working on, it was like 4 megs.
Yeah.
I mean, it'll work if you're just doing, and the other thing about local storage analysis is just keep adding pairs. So you need to build out like a full-blown entity relationship of data objects. But if you know that it's just, there could be a flat table key value pairs, and it's under 4 megs, then it's fine. There was a client that we do business with that does these embedded systems, and they end up using WebSQL because they couldn't use it. That's why the storage was not quite, it was a little too small, it was just a little too restricted to do things and they were using WebSQL.
That
might
be a bit more
advice. WebSQL's good.
Or you can actually use like a SQL plugins.
Yeah, then you're just limited by whatever you can. Store in SQL. And now the downside of WebSQL is it's not all browsers support
it. Right. Android and iOS are used to. But yeah, if you're trying to get out of you're trying to get out of the web, like Firefox, I see.
You ever check out Kennedy's?
Yeah.
Kennedy's? Yeah. There's a site on Kennedy's.com that shows you what everybody supports. So then you can see. So Android, it's all Android always has the always support for all this stuff. So can I use, just so you guys know, we're talking about HTML 5 clients. And can I use is a really good site for checking things out, checking out what it supports well. I guess it's just like Firefox ID that support. If that's not something that you, if you're not building something out, that you know is going to have to support IE, it is a great solution. It's getting used in a lot of ways. Anything else? So in the interest of time, I'm gonna circumvent doing demo stuff too much. I'll put it out to you guys. If there's anything out of any of this hybrid stuff you want to maybe look at more, just to let you know. So there we go. I've got this set up in here. I've got this web folder that is my web app. And then I have an Android app that has an external reference to it. That's just loading the entire, and this is the same scaven thing that I showed you guys earlier. Same web app. This Android project has a reference to it, and then this iOS project has an external reference to it. So both of these guys are sharing the same code base. And this is on a much smaller scale, very similar to some things I've done in the past. So I did this event to sort of illustrate this TAO thing with some of the dudes from KDP to sort of illustrate how easy it is to do a very basic single web view hybrid application. There's not a huge amount to it. This is not a good example. But basically all you have to do is once you have a web view, this is my web view here. Once you have it, then if you're talking iOS, and there's a similar pattern with Android. You get a reference to the file path, and then you just and because this is running on the file system within the sandbox of the native container. You get a reference to the path, and then you just load it. And that gets you don't have to do much more than that to get a hybrid app up and running. It's just pure hybrid, and it's not talking to any container. There's really very little to it. So there's that. Now, to sort of reinforce this thing that I was talking about before. So this is a native container, and it's got all of this crazy stuff. The scaven application I set up to work disconnected as a thing, because I felt like one use case for the application would be going forest hills, forest park. The scaven would run probably have good connections, so you might need to have to work disconnected. So there's all this scaffolding in here to basically intercept requests, REST requests coming from. So you can do this thing with web views. The way a lot of this stuff works with the phone gap. Probably the same thing that I'm similar to the thing, right? It's JavaScript. They leverage these JavaScript interfaces.
I'm not sure if
they have some kind of problem. So web views, you can actually, with the web views in Android and iOS, you can actually intercept the traffic moving back and forth between these small web apps. It's going to be different somewhere.
Yeah, I guess there's no web view.
And what you can do if you're rolling your native container, and again, this is how a lot of this stuff works, is you can intercept those requests and do something meaningful with them. So these phone gap JavaScript APIs, I'm assuming work. It's pretty much what I did with this stuff here. So you can build this stuff out and then sort of follow a command pattern to convert these things to delegate out to classes to do things. So I have this, there's a RESTful GET call that happens, for example, on Scaven that gets all of the scavenger hunt games back as JSON. Now when it talks to the web service, it gets that back as JSON. For disconnected mode, I'm actually intercepting that and then delegating out to this GET scavenger request operation. And it's got request operation. It's actually fetching this stuff out of a that way, it gives you, again, if you're really flexible, really, really robust solutions, you can extend, you can mix native views to your heart's content. Downside is that's a lot of work. Then, got something similar for. Much more simplified version, but it just basically illustrates the fact that if you're supporting iOS and Android, you end up going down the path of having to write this stuff twice. So this is something that I just threw together very quickly, but I did it to sort of illustrate that way that you can actually share the web. So I actually have a symlink in here that is an external reference to the web folder that I showed you. And this will run that same web app. It just doesn't have any of the intercept stuff built into it. You can do the same thing with Android, but again, it is a fair amount of work. Any questions about that stuff?
What has been the experience of people that have worked on and offline while hearing on search?
What's that?
What kind of experience have people had like working on and offline using those type of hybrid apps? Like, have they noticed a difference, slow down their speed up?
Well, it speeds up when you're running disconnected, right? Because it's actually faster. It's faster when it's fetching stuff out of the native container when it's working in the intercepts of disconnected mode, because it doesn't have to go out to the outside world.
They don't know this is switching around and stuff. It's all intercepted.
It's just intercepted. The buzz around thing I worked on actually worked disconnected. It wasn't something you could selectively connect to disconnect. You had to be online long enough to log in so you can get authenticated into the domain. And then after that, just pull a bunch of JSON, save the poly objects, and it was always pretty fast out. But yeah, it's faster. It is a lot of work. Anything else? I'm going to take titanium out of that slot. I can smell it. So I wanted to talk about shrink wrap hybrid a little bit now. What are the pros of it? It's been my experience that it's good for throwing together prototypes pretty quickly. When I was working on the Bust the Ground project, I threw something together very quickly to show off. It was enough to show off the idea that the experience could share enough of the code base to have the same experience between the desktop and mobile, and do it quite a bit less expensively than if you were to do web desktop version. A lot of people use it for real things. Like Jason pointed out, he sent me some links to some stuff. Maybe go somewhere that give us some good examples of stuff that was built. Is it working for you?
I think I don't remember.
It just all depends on what you're trying to do. It can be used for it can be used to build good things. It's just like Jason was saying to me, really just comes down to good design. If you're not paying attention to the fact that you're building a hybrid solution for a mobile device, then you're going to lose yourself in trouble. It can work in production as long as you know definitively that the business will never have to convert that project to native, which they can do. The downside of using something like PhoneGap is there's no way to migrate out of it incrementally. It ends up being a thing of, okay, well, we're going to go off for 6 months, or we're going to get another team, and then we're going to start building it, and we're just going to throw it stuff away. Most of them cost money. The phone, Quarterly you can get for free, PhoneGap is free to the point, but like stuff like CentureTouch, which is hybrid, yes, CentureTouch. Sensor Touch is hybrid and at this cost. Okay.
So check out this real quick. Oh, 724. Holy cow.
Any questions about any of that stuff? I was going to show some examples, but you know, I can put them up on my GitHub and send you guys links if you want to check out later. There's also this stuff that's going on. This guy over here told me about some of this thing. There's you guys heard about this thing that Phone Gap does now, where they build your stuff for you. So you can do this thing where if you have an Adobe ID account. So you can actually upload, you can build out a higher level application. You can either zip it up or you can give this Phone Gap build thing, the GitHub hook, to your application, and those guys will build it for you. And that way you never have to touch Xcode or Opcode, or Android Studio or any of that stuff. That if you're in an organization where there's people jumping up the web devs and they don't want to spare themselves of the other details of another language, then this is one good way to just upload your stuff here and then they send you a completed APK. There's also this thing that somebody else turned me on to called Codica. And Codica actually has like an online IDE. So you can go into this thing and build your thing. I've got my little tribute to Gang 4 application. You guys know Gang 4 is? You do? And I just built this thing, you just drag stuff in there, and then you can build it. You can either get them to, you can export the entire Phone Gap project, the entire project as a Phone Gap project, or you can actually have them build it. I have to do it for the manager. They just sent you an email back. It says, hey, your cookies are baked. Cookies are all done. Where are my cookies, Jason? Yeah. Oh, here. System. Yeah. Yeah, so I can so they built an APK for me. But I can go out here and just download the APK. So there's that. I have a friend that actually used that for a real project. Not judging.
I'm trying so hard.
Non-judgmental. We're all friends here. All friends, Jake. Okay, so I don't have too much more time. I'm going to spend the last little bit of it talking a little bit about Xamarin. You guys know what Xamarin is? So Xamarin was this thing that was started out by a group of dudes that were working at Novell a few years ago, and they it's the same dudes that built Mono, and they went off and started tinkering with Mono and figured out that they could make it run on devices, and that initially became MonoTouch, and MonoTouch became Mono for Android. Then they all quit, or they all got fired, or some sort of thing happened, and then they started this company Xamarin against Columbia. And now it's a full-blown platform for doing cross-platform development in C#. So if you're .NET dev, it's great. Jake Hall over there came from a shop, and there was a shop full of .NET devs, and proposed it, and they were like, yes. And that shop is still using all that stuff now. And if you're used to C#, Xamarin's gotten pretty good. They actually bought this company. What's that company they bought that does test on itself?
Less painful.
What's that?
Less painful.
Less painful? No, it was TestBot.
Now it's TestBot.
TestBot.
It was less painful.
Oh, it was less painful.
They rebranded it.
Right, it's TestBot. Yeah, so they bought their own. One of the things that's really difficult, really, really difficult about iOS, I should have talked about, is if you are in a shop that's that is trying to adhere to standards like TDD and trying to get good unit test coverage and stuff. iOS is like 10 years behind everyone. Like, there's no locking frameworks for stuff. It's really, there's no locking frameworks for stuff. I mean, you have to kind of, you have to, you're still back in the place for those of you that have like done things with unit testing. Kind of back in this like 2005 place where you have to build like big classes and stuff and you know, do all this crazy typing stuff. That's not fun. So, one of the nice things is about doing calling something like Xamarin, if you're a .NET guy, then it's .NET, you know, you can use Rhino Launch, you can do all the test correctly and all this the right way. Jake turned me on to this new thing that the kids are using with Xamarin called the whole class libraries. So what you used to have to do, the thing that they have, there's a big white paper on the Xamarin side, one of the things that they used to have to do, that people still do probably, is if you're building, if you're setting up a single Visual Studio solution that is supposed to, that you want to have support to Android and iOS, what folks did up until the portable class library stuff is they would either reference assemblies from an external project or they would link files, right, Jake? And portable class libraries is a way to do away with all that. And it's this thing that Xamarin came up with that allows you to compile assemblies for cross-platform. So you don't have to do anything specific, right? The only constraints are that you have to stick to certain parts of the framework that are platform framework, right? So as long as you're doing that, which is for the most part is like business logic that you're going to use in any application, then it's great. So I just actually pulled the TASKI solution off the site, and so this is their PCL thing, and this is all their business logic, and then at compile time, this library right here. Is referenced for both the iOS application and the Android application. And this is a single code base that can build iOS and Android. It does WinPhone 2, but I'm on Mac, so it can't really actually load it. It's just a little TASKI application. That's fine. Okay, there it is. So you can see I made my reminder for you, Pop, and make his dog okay to let it in. Susie Sue had to get new guitar player for the benches. So there's that, and then you can run this thing if I can push it. So I can change the startup project from there. And I guess this will run there it is. And there's the task manager. So same code base. It's using all the same SQLite stuff. All this logic is getting shared between the two. And there's a task manager for Android. So real good solution if it's .NET shell. Now here's the thing about Xamarin. It costs cash money. It's a yearly hit. And what is it, Jake? It's like
$1,000 per developer per platform.
Right. Yeah. So. It made sense for the organization that Jake worked at. They had the money to do it. They already had the resources. And you know, for them, probably it made the most sense because they didn't have for what they would have spent for extra resources. It was a wash.
We need both too. So accelerates getting multi-platform out the door.
What was it? Yeah, that is the downside. It does cost quite a bit of money. It can be hard sometimes to pitch the business on something. But, it's nice. It's really nice. It's really nice, Jake Call. Really nice. Okay, that's it. Questions? Anybody? Yes?
Just wondering what your thoughts are on like game engine development tools like Unity 3D.
Ask this guy. can I say anything?
No. Nope. Lost customer. That's a big drawback. It's tough for business apps, right? How do you take a big chunk of data and display it in 3D, right? What UI support do you get, and how many third-party libraries or plugins for Unity do you have to go get just to display data? If you're building a first-person shooter, absolutely. With it now, it gives you sprites that doesn't give you grids of tables of data. So I think to Dee's earlier point, it's all about the context of the problem you're trying to solve. If it's a business app, Unity's a hard sell.
Were you thinking about it more?
Not like crunching a lot of, it'd be like logging data. So that would be one.
If you're trying to shoot a rocket launcher, then absolutely, Unity is a good solution.
Yeah. If all of this is logging data, I would look at other ways to do this. Because there is a cost associated with it.
Yeah.
Yes?
I was going to say there's another solution similar to different, and there's a little company out in Hillsboro that makes a thing called XDK.
XDK.
Yes. XDKintel.com.
What's the website?
XDK.intel.com.
Oh, somebody presented this.
That's
something
on.
Yeah. Was it you?
It was me and another guy.
Oh, you use car salesman. Look at this guy.
But it's also.
Yeah, I saw it. The tools are nice.
Yeah, it's for if you want to do a hybrid app, a la like phone the app.
Yes.
It's a lot more developed than what PhoneGap provides, but it runs under the same kind of mechanism underneath.
XDK.
That Intel. That.
Intel. Right. So it's an endeavor that Intel's doing, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. So this gentleman here, there was an earlier mobile Portland event where he did a demo and stuff, and it's a collection of tools for building hybrid apps, right? Android specific, or is it?
No, you can build to Android, Windows 8 Phone, iOS. We're adding others. The nice thing about those three is there's a little app you can load onto your device and then push the HTML5 into it so that you have like a, kind of think of it as an empty hybrid container that can use the HTML stuff so you can play with it and run it right there and do a real fast, you know, cycle of debug.
Yes.
So on the website that after Xamarin you mentioned Rogue Mobile. Is that
I that said Dusty because I wasn't sure if I was going to have time to talk about it.
Have you heard of Rogue? Yeah, a while ago, but then Motorola bought it and I thought like that would go in. But
you know, I'm honestly not sure. I just remember I was working on a project a couple years ago and one of the guys on the team was any of you guys Ruby developer in the room brings up the fact that I didn't turn around and go, yes, there's a cross-platform framework out there called Rose that started out as an open source thing, right? And then the world sucked up. So there's this thing called Rhodes that allows you to write Ruby once and deploy. I guess it does support Deploying to iPhone, Android, RIM, Windows Mobile, Windows Phone 7. There's my desktop. Thanks for bringing that. Anything else? All right, lads. Thank you for your time.
Next month, May 19th, and I believe it's going to be some folks from eBay talking to us. Can't remember if it's May or maybe a couple months from now, but please join us next month. And thank you again to Dee. Thank you to our sponsors. See you guys later. Have a good night.
For anybody that wants to continue the conversation across the street, a few of us are going to wander around the road and just grab a beer.
Okay.